Hi, this is Annie Dance. I'm an investigative journalist. Please subscribe if you haven't already to anniedance.substack.com. I am working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Lake Lower Rutherford County and beyond. You can simply type your email into here and hit subscribe or click no thanks. Because I'm already subscribed using this email address, it will behave a little bit differently than what you may experience. But when I hit subscribe, I want to show you that it will offer you the subscription plans. So if you like what you read and hear with my journalism, I greatly appreciate your support. You can join monthly, annually, become a founding member, or none. Then there's various tiers that offer different things. But if you click none, just a note, you will only get the public post and you won't be able to comment on any of the stories. I greatly appreciate your support. When you go and visit the website, you could also see the full archive and you'll have access to the entire archive with a paid membership as a paid subscriber. What's really interesting, what I like to look at is what are you reading? What stories are important to you, my readers? So you can get a sense of that by clicking on the top button and under the archive tab. And you can also hit the newer button, which shows you the newest posts. Today, I'm going to share a conversation that was held on earlier in February. I was going to say earlier this month, but today is March 1st. So in late February, on February 20th, a community meeting was held at Lake Lower Town Hall featuring Duke Energy representatives discussing electric services issues in the town and neighboring areas of Rutherford County and beyond. Of course, Lake Lower in the western part of the county, it hits several different other counties, Buncombe, Henderson, and Polk counties. So if my internet cooperates, I'm going to play that for you in full. I seem to always be doing these chats on days with extreme weather. Right now, it's been sleeting and pouring rain, so I do hope my internet stays up to speed with that. And I'll share that in a moment. But first, let me give you some situational awareness and lay of the land, what I experienced attending that meeting. Approximately 30 residents attended, expressing concerns about frequent outages. They inquired about vegetation management, storm response plans, energy costs, and the possibility of converting lines to underground. Duke Energy's team, led by Craig DeBrew, who's a local government and community relations manager, presented topics including the electric system design, common causes of the outages, transmission infrastructure, and distribution facilities. He acknowledged residents' frustrations, apologized for service shortcomings, and emphasized Duke's commitment to improvement. The presentation, which I will share in my Substack news article, highlighted challenges posed by the mountainous terrain, vegetation issues, the cost and impracticality of converting feeders underground, and Duke outlined measures taken to enhance reliability, such as system upgrades and backfeed capabilities. Now, during the question and answer session, attendees were encouraged to report hazard trees, and Duke committed to an enhanced tree trimming cycle, including use of a helicopter. Finally, Mayor Carol Pritchett thanked Duke for their engagement and efforts to address communities' concerns. After the meeting, Duke personnel engaged individually with attendees. So the meeting itself lasted almost over an hour and a half. I'm going again attempt to play that for you in its entirety. If you were unable to attend in person, there were about the town reports on their website that there were 30 attendees, but I would say that there were more about 15 to 20 actual residents, and then a number of the attendees were town staff. Then the additional people were the about seven people from Duke Energy. So it was very interesting. I think the large takeaway for me was the fact that it's a mountainous terrain, trees are a big issue, there's very little you can do to be proactive unless you're prepared to take down trees. So here's what they said. I will highlight before I start the recording of what was said. It's unclear why the town did not record this. I think it's a very important issue affecting life and property and just every aspect of life in Lake Lore. But the town did provide a summary from the community meeting on their website. And in that, I'll post this text to my story too. So in that, it describes who attended from Duke and what I shared a moment ago, as well as the PowerPoint presentation itself from Duke that you can look at that will give you some more interesting detail when you zoom in about what is discussed. So I did not go through, just a programming note, I did not go through each individual speaker to label them who was speaking, but these are the folks who attended and who spoke from Duke Energy. And just a lay of the land here with Otter AI that I use to transcribe speech. It provides a summary of each conversation. And this is a few different parts, but overall, the management of Duke Energy and the electricity infrastructure was discussed, and concerns were raised about the reliability of the current system. The cost to that was also discussed, but not in that great detail. This was more to do with, as I said, the trees and the vegetation. In the beginning, you'll hear some community folks talk, and they were asking questions, and then those questions get addressed later on.
Someone seems to be aware that spraying radio as a testing management system is in fact I know personally in the tour as well as in that case. I watched so spraying radio on custody first is infected to people that we think we can all have a custody problem. We don't like it. We need to get rid of it. Problem is that spraying glyphosate contained material on kudzu is ineffective in controlling it. And it does pose an immediate risk to electric lines. But I'm wondering, does Duke have any plans to maybe use one? Seems to me that that would mean shut down when you're ready for control for needing spraying kudzu or purchasing any doctor at all from really a lot better anyway. And second, it seems to me that very high, even helpful in terms of managing trees around the line. I noticed that his current policy around tree management seems to be to cut the trees in place and then leave them on the ground. This is not a this contributes to completely high on the fire risk. And I'm sure you know we had a major loss of the management team. And then leading dead logs in place, leading up against five trees, stage five and nine. As a community member, I'd love to know what we can do differently in terms of the management, if there is a community line, and if you can stop spraying rodeo on such a different collection.
I think partly because of that, a lot of people have spent 5 years on backup power generation. I've never seen that anywhere. So many people have so many money on backup power generation. Okay. My question is there any anticipation that Duke might help offset some of that cost? Okay. Because it's a lot. The second one is that's about a long time ago, but obviously most of us are doing my vegetation or get that. But there's a lot of noise, brief interruptions, 2 to 3 5 seconds, dips, frowns. So, you know, there's not only a quantity issue, but a quality issue. And that I don't really understand as much. You know, the big tree fall because it's on a steep slope and all that stuff is part of it. But why do we have so many issues with just noise amount? My monitoring equipment on my automation equipment told me that we've had 7 incidents just in the last 24 weeks of brief brownouts, brief interruptions, noise. So, anyway, those are my three questions.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Hillary Gossel, and I'm a community member as well. I'm going to take my comments in a little bit different direction. I am concerned with rate increases across the board. Lakeville has a community of people who live on the state now. And my proposed tax rates in the dollar cents don't really amount to a lot. But for some of us in our community, an added $10 a month in our electric bill can pose some kind of challenge. I read your article that was on your website. I also looked at the resources that you provide as a benefit to people who come and browse through your literature. I looked at what it would take for someone on a fixed income to get assistance through the county under the crisis and or through your weatherization program. The weatherization program, while it is a phenomenal idea, and I personally have taken part in that, it falls short in some of the houses that still exist in Lakewood today. And there are families who cannot afford to winterize or weatherize homes that would greatly impact their overall electric use and their electric bill. And I'm wondering, with this rate increase, would a benefit to those of us who are not influenced, who most people that live in the town, be able to take some kind of advantage to you increasing your weatherization program? Windows and roofs are very, but there has to be some middle ground that the electric company can offer to its consumer to help reduce the heat cost with enough savings the consumer additional money. And on a side note, when people live on fixed income, whether it's Social Security, disability, or veterans benefit, and we get a 3.9% cost of living increase, it's very discouraging when our payment increase for the year of our expenses exceeds 43.2%. And that is essentially also adding the 7.73% that you all are wanting to impose on us. That counts as a 4.9% over the next 2 years if my figures are correct. So I'm trying to put a human stake on the dollars in which you all are asking for. I understand the cost of doing business, but please also understand there is a human cost as well. Thank you.
Anyone else have a question?
Sure.
Hi, my name is Liz Gary. I'm here representing Humbling Mall. Just a quick question and comment. We've been trying to work with communications companies about locating dangling very low water on Young Mountain for quite some time. The last update that we received, we're trying over the course of the year to get resolved with that. They don't do anything until the due holes are replaced or repaired. So there are very few places in Rumbling Mall that have utilities that aren't buried. Young Mountain is one of them, and the post fire there are in extremely bad shape. I went through and got the post numbers before and tried to report it to Duke. That was in April of last year, and nothing's taken effect there. The cables are so low, I thought a little board matters. It's not tall. The cables are maybe that high above the roof of my truck. So delivery trucks or construction vehicles or emergency vehicles coming through there, it's going to be rough in that area. We don't maintain that right of way. We don't have anything to do with vegetation along that right of way. There's very little we can do. So anything that costs is going to be good.
About 4 years ago, we were told, the solar families, for our business, and we were told that, I don't know if you guys have anything to do with this or not, but in that metering system, there would be a rebate, and we were put on the list, and when I checked the list, it was, this, small names on a many number of pages. And apparently that just went to the wayside. I don't know why or if you guys have any information on any of that, but that's not your issue, but the company that sold this was out in silver. They're now.
Anybody else? And as the meeting goes on, after the presentation, there's certainly opportunity to follow up with any other questions. But we certainly appreciate the input. That's the whole point of having an increased way to have some of the questions come up. So I think we'll leave it to you, Mr. Craig Drew, who is the community relations manager.
Well, thank you, Mayor Pritchett. We appreciate the opportunity to be here, and thank y'all for taking your time to come and express your concern and let us know where we're not meeting your expectations. You can rest assured that we need to deliver safe, reliable, affordable electricity to our customers in the area. And so, I've got a little presentation. We use terminology that the general public's not doesn't commonly use. So I'm going to run through some things and talk about how we serve this area and some of the challenges that we face and some of the things we need to address. And while I'm getting set up to do that, I'm going to ask my colleagues here to introduce themselves and talk about what your job function is at Duke Energy and what role you will play in reliability here in Hickory Nut Gorge. And Alan, I'll start with you on that end.
So yes, my name is Alan Green. I've been at Duke for 23 years.
I'm staying put. I'm a supervisor at Spindale for our craft and maintenance, so I have all the linemen that work in the area. And anytime there's outages, I'm using Spindale's computer and trying to get people to come this way to help out. When there's outages at your home, you get an auto-generated message to begin with. That's something that's done by the computer. If we're in storm mode, it's how many feet, how many boots have on the ground, and I make those decisions trying to figure out how long it'll be. From my engineers, when they're doing the scout, looking to see when we can get your power back on. And I try to, you know, be as definite as possible as we can. We looked at was this area because it's too hard to gauge. And Lake Lure is, I'm passionate about Lake Lure. I live in the county, lived here my whole life. I love Lake Lure. I love coming to the lake. I like to come up here and eat. When I was a lineman, this area was very challenging. As a supervisor, it's been way more challenging. I have talked to, I don't know how many customers, I don't know how many people call my phone when there's a problem. And feel free to call me anytime. I'll be as far as up here if you have a phone. You can't get somebody, you're getting, you know, you're calling, you're getting a runaround, call me. I'll leave my number, you can call my cell phone number any time of the day. I'll take a call, I'll give you the best answer I can give you. I'm usually giving you a better answer than you're going to get from somebody in Charlotte. I'll do everything I can to try to help you. If our guy's checking the property or your yard or something like that, doing something, I'm the guy that comes to it and I get them up here and up here to fix it. There's plenty of a lot of bats in that department, but Lake Lure is the furthest point from our Spindale office. So a lot of people sometimes think that it's on the back burner. It's not. It's just 45 minutes to get here from all the trucks and drive around all the curves. So I'm passionate about this place and hope this meeting goes well. If you have any questions for me, feel free to ask.
Matt Robinson, area support role, which consists of engineering. Right now, oversight and contractor support. The reliability is a big footprint. I cover Hickory, Marion, Shelby, Spindale, and literally work with these guys all the time on how to make things better. And, what can we do? How do we get back on? How do we get this, that, and the other? It is a bug, for sure. But it's a good experience to try to learn and try to be better up here.
I've been kind of in this company for 4 years, and part of my job is to help the reliability up here. And a lot of the new thing that you're seeing in the air, I have to create some of that stuff and cause it to happen. But like I say, I'm the same way. If I can ever help any of you, reach out to me. There's a lot of issues up here that's hard to solve. But I'll be glad to work with EYP.
I'm Mr. Walker. I'm the manager for our distribution and vegetation program. I'm going to take care of our region of Carolina footprint, which basically covers from Greenwood, South Carolina, to the Durham area, sweeps all the way back around to the Nantahala area. So, a lot of footprint there. I've got a staff of ISA certified arborists that manage the smaller portions of the area that that we maintain. So Paul Kunal is my VMP manager for this particular area. We're always really available to also my contact information. Looking forward to expanding a little bit more on the vegetation program, the challenges of a mountain terrain versus that Houston urban environment you were discussing earlier. But we could talk about that in a little detail and tell you how we manage our vegetation program and hopefully give you some level of confidence in that for you.
Hey, Smith, lead management manager for the area. We've been studying about some business cards, our call center. I'm sorry. You're a better contact. And a good possibility, I've already spoken to him, met with some of you folks before. I've been out on the customer issues, the plants, if you will, about the trees, the spraying. This brings somebody to your client, so you have a direct line, so to speak.
So that's the theme, and I'm going to give you just a quick overview, and then they're the subject matter experts. And so I'm going to start off with just by helping you understand, and can everybody see okay? I'm not seeing you guys well. So we use a lot of terms, so I'm going to give you a just quick and dirty electricity 101 of how we provide electric service to our customers in the Carolinas and in the Lake Lure area. And you can see this is a simplified utility system, and it starts with the transmission. So I'll be talking about transmission and distribution. It takes both of y'all to keep the lights, both of those, to keep the lights on. So
We have a transmission line. It's at 44,000 volts. Down at the substation at the dam, we set that voltage down to 12,000 volts. And then we distribute electricity on what we call distribution feeder. So you'll hear us use that term feeder. And then all those feeders, we have tap lines. So you'll hear us use that term. And so the tap lines come off the main feeders. Now, in the substation, we have a feeder breaker that's just kind of does what the breaker does in your home. If you have a fault in your home, that breaker will trip. If you have an overload, that breaker will trip. And the breakers in our substation are very similar, except most of the faults in our system are temporary. So that is a squirrel scampers up a transformer, he's standing on the tank, he reaches up, and he touches that energized primary lead coming down. It creates a fault. And so that circuit breaker will open for a tenth of a second, and then it'll automatically reclose. And 75% of the time, the system goes back to normal. So we avoided an outage, but we did have a momentary interruption. So that's what the feeder breaker does. Now, what if there's a fault that takes longer to clear itself? A limb that's fallen down into the line. Well, that feeder breaker will actually go through three operations, and then on the fourth operation, if that fault's still there, it will lock out. So you've all seen that phenomenon before. You see the lights blink, they'll blink, and then after about three times, it's like it's not coming back. So we've got a permanent fault in our system that we've got to clear. So the idea is to maintain service to customers and clear areas where there's fault. So if we just have one feeder breaker and it's 40 miles long, we wouldn't want to trip all those customers if there was a fault anywhere on the system. So we have cascading protective devices. So we may have a fuse on a tap line. So if a squirrel or a tree limb, car muscle fault, something happens and there's a fault out on this tap line, then we'll blow that fuse. Instead of having 1,200 people off, then we may have 30 people off. And we also deploy a device that we call a recloser that kind of acts like a feeder breaker. It sees a fault and it will open. So if there's a fault on this tap line, this recloser will open. And these customers here don't see that blink. They may see a open sag. Most people are not that impacted by a holding sag. But so these customers would see that momentary interruption 75% of the time. That fault clears itself, the breaker closes back, systems goes back to normal. So these are really good in helping us isolate. From this side of here, I'm showing two reclosers. And so that's typically what we have. We'll have multiple reclosers on the system. And again, so if you have a problem down here, then that recloser is going to open and lock it out. These customers are going to maintain the service. So that's the idea behind the science argument. So, what's our connection to the grid? Our connection is down Lake Ash or the Turner Shoals. So we've got a transmission line that comes up from there and feeds the substation, which is down at the dam. And so that's our connection to the grid, the 44,000 volt transmission line. Those lines have a higher level of reliability than our distribution lines do. They have a 5-foot right of way. This line has a 58-foot right of way, so it's 34 feet on either side. And so we get good performance for transmission lines. They do occasionally have problems. And I'll talk about a couple of those here, but that's our connection to the grid.
I'm just going to pause for a second and highlight that very, very important point. He's saying that Lake Lore is getting power from Lake Adger in Polk County. So think about that and the geography of that. Also the importance of that line and that connection to Polk County.
You see it coming up from Lake Adger. So one of the problems that we had was during Hurricane Zeta back in 2020, and that was a very interesting time for us. That morning, I got some notes from our transmission folks. We had, that morning, we lost the line at, 8:30 that morning. And in a span of about an hour, we lost 10 circuits in this area, 10 transmission circuits within an hour. That's a big deal. And we were able to get all 10 of those restored within 48 hours. So here's a note. Part of my job is to communicate with key leaders and communicate with elected officials and emergency management professionals on what's happening. So this, I pulled this note up that I sent to our elected officials and fire chief and said, you know, Rutherford County was one of the hardest hit areas in the Carolinas. We suffered significant damage on the transmission grid. We've got 16,000 customers out that morning. That's like 58% of all our customers in Rutherford County. So that was a tough morning for us. So my friend Sammy, okay, Sammy said, call him if you're, please don't call Sammy when the lights are out. Sammy's busy getting the light. I try to avoid calling Sammy. So if you've got a problem, we're not responding. Reach out to one of your elected officials and just say, hey, I didn't see a big truck in my neighborhood. And the mayor and council members will let them. My goal is to give them updates at least once a day and usually twice a day. And they'll be able to tell you what's going on. And if there's something falling through the cracks, then let them give you my contact information. But don't bother sending these bits. Especially in the storm. Now, if it's a one-off, you know, but in a situation like that, these guys are doing their thing. Talk to me. I talk about getting the lights on. They actually get the lights on. So that's some of the things we do. That was a big deal for us. We had another transmission outage this past July, and you've seen this tree right here. You've got a 68-foot right-of-way. This tree is a live, healthy oak tree, 10 feet outside the right-of-way, fell onto the line. It fell onto the line at 6:30 p.m. that late that afternoon. It was muddy, inaccessible. Our guys had to go out and pull the wire off insulators on five or six locations. They had to go climb all these poles by climb them manually. And got it back on by 5:30 the next morning, so about 11-hour outage. So our transmission guys stepped up on that one. But again, this tree outside the right way is a common theme of my remarks today. We're impacted a lot by trees outside our lanes. So there's a transmission, and I'll just share you this. Lake Lure is kind of remote. Part of the appeal, you know, you kind of feel like you're getting away when you come up here, and that creates a challenge for us because we've only got this one transmission feed up here, so we're relying on that one. I think it's about 8 or 9 miles up from Lake Adger to maintain service here. So,
may I ask a question about your title? Hi, I'm Annie Dance. I'm a journalist. To the north is rugged terrain and sparse population estates. Yeah. So can you clarify what sparse population means? Because in Lake Lore, there's approximately 2,000 so year-round residents, and that number grows exponentially in certain months of the year.
A lot of places you see our substations are on a grid network. So there's more a need for transmission capacity for customer capacity up in this area. So that transmission line is built, it taps the grid down here, comes up to Lake Lure, but there's just not a lot of load or a lot of customers up in this area. And also the co-op has some areas, service areas over there.
Yeah, Rutherford Electric has a lot of that.
Yes,
between Rutherford and on that side too.
Exactly.
It's got that better community on this side.
Exactly. Yeah. So that's the transmission. And so let's talk about distribution. And that's mainly what are impacting you folks. We've got two distribution feeders. And this one, it goes up to the north, up toward Rumbling Ball. And it has around 1,676 customers, and you can see where it kind of follows Buffalo Shoals as it goes up. And then the other feeder comes out on the lower side of the lake and goes all the way, of course, we're here at Town Hall. It goes all the way up to Batgate and beyond the curtain. And that particular feeder has 81 miles of exposure, and that's a lot, okay? And then the, and so I'm going to call that the Town Hall feeder, since that's where we are, and we'll call this the Fairfield feeder. And so you see it has about 40 miles of exposure. And I mentioned those electronic reflosers, those breakers. We have those deployed on these feeders, and I think there's six on the main feeder backbone going up to Rumbling Bog, and then there's eight on the one headed back towards the back cave. So that's how that works now. And if we look at this location and we kind of zero in on where we're sitting, you see we've got the circuit that runs along Memorial Highway. It comes out here to Town Hall, and that's about 5 miles. And so, you know, here's the source of that. So if there's a tree that falls here or a tree falls across the road, if there's a problem, then we're going to lose everything beyond that. But if we have, if there's a problem out in here somewhere, then we're going to have one of these that we can open, isolate that problem and keep these customers on. In addition to the electronic devices, we also have manual devices. There's switches and knife switches. There are other places we can open. And whenever Sandy's folks come out and they roll up, and they say it's going to be a while, they immediately think about, okay, what can we do switching-wise to minimize the number of customers that are impacted by this accident? All right, so what causes the outage? Well, weather's a big driver. Thunderstorms, snowstorms, ice rain, etc. Vegetation is a big cause. Trees inside the right-of-way, sometimes we'll have a limb fall out of a tree. But the big one is trees outside the right-of-way. Now, on the distribution line, I told you on transmission, it's a 68-foot right-of-way. On distribution, it's only a 30-foot right-of-way. So we have 15 feet on either side of that line. And we do a pretty good job maintaining that 15 feet on either side. But a lot of those outages that we've seen are.
I recorded you email again. I'll do a second.
Right
about chicken.
Vehicle accidents. We get a whole lot of those. I think we get some. Squirrel, birds, equipment, put some rumbling bottles. We have underground cable failures, and we spend a lot of money. Danny, I know you're placing a lot of underground cable in those areas. Third-party interference and planned outages. So let's look at those number of outages. So here are the customer minutes out for this location. If you're in the back cave, it's going to be different. If you're back closer to the dam, it's going to be different. But that's going to be kind of in the ballpark. So here are the outages, and you can see the outlier is really in 2018 when we had the big snowstorm. And if you include that, you're looking at, you know, an average of 1,600 minutes out a year. If you kind of normalize and take that out, you know, the last 6 years have been more in still 20 hours a year average outage time. For this location, and you see 2020 was really impacted by that hurricane. And not only did we have transmission problems, we had also distribution problems too. So that kind of increased our outage numbers there. Near that snowstorm, the so that's Lake Moore Town Hall. During the past 5 years, 71% of these customer minutes out are due to trees outside the right of way. And we'll talk about how we address those. But that's a huge number. And then if you look at Fairfield Mountain, I just picked the spot of the fire department up there. And so again, you see the 2018 customer minutes out, huge. actually out 63, right at 63 hours. And so you take the average there, 32 hours. If you normalize that snowstorm, then you're down to 6. Those are the customer minutes out at those two locations. And during the last 5 years, 89% of those minutes are due to trees outside the right of way. So as we have gone in and rebuilt our feeders and got bigger wire going up Buffalo Shoals Road, we've got double circuit, which is good. It's a little bit of a double-edged sword. When a big tree outside the right of way is falling with an L-point line, so it just takes time to do it. And so that's why we've seen some pretty high houses. Now, let's talk about vantage management. And as I said, we have a 30-foot right-of-way. We last trimmed this circuit coming around the town hall. We trimmed it in 2008, trimmed it again in 2017, and it's being trimmed again right now. Helicopter training is going to take place next week. So, hey, this is your notification, all right? So, if you can see these guys right here, this is what it's going to look like. They're going to be in 20 different locations. They're going to be trimming about 10 miles of line with the helicopter. So, for areas, that are difficult to get to, can't get bucket trucks to it, it's just hard to maintain. The helicopter is actually a pretty good solution. If you look at this little photo here of before and after, you see it does a pretty good job going through and clearing that right away. So there'll be places just right up the road from Flowering Bridge where a line crosses the river. We're going to be deploying it back along bottomless pools. There's a line that cuts across the side of the mountain, like nearly a mile long. We'll be doing trimming there. So I saw your hand. We'll take a question. Let you guys answer a question that you have about helicopter trimming.
Yeah. Oh, great. Helicopter trimming. It's awfully complicated. We vary the lines to make it feel a little bit easier and stable in the long run, especially with the rate increases that we're seeing because of the cost.
So there is a line. We'll jump in there. And that's the question you get. And, we're happy to talk about that. So if you think about the main feeder, there's thousands of customers relying on that service. As opposed to a subdivision where we've got a box and we're going down a cul-de-sac, we direct bury that. So we just trench hole, throw in the cable, and that's called direct bury. Sometimes we may put it in conduit. But for main feeder backbone, that has to be in what they call a duct bait. So it's concrete encased conduit. So it's these numbers are 5 years old, $1,250 a foot that are or what we see. And that's going up, I'm sure, probably a third. So even at 1250, if you think about just the 5 miles from here to the dam, it's $33 million. It's probably over 40 now. And there's no really flat place along the side of the road to put it too. So the bottom line is that the underground is just cost prohibitive. But the helicopter in maintaining overhead lines is actually a cost effective solution in certain places with certain applications.
That does not incredibly expensive. I do wonder if there have been any cost comparisons. For example, cost to customers, the amount of hours we see the trees falling on unburied lines, and the cost of maintaining the helicopter, and still thought that burying the line would be even more expensive than that.
Yeah, you still have problems, you still have ongoing maintenance. Still have issues with underground. In a place like Charlotte, where there's underground vaults, you just trade one set of problems for a different set of problems. And so all that stuff is it's a real experience no matter.
And it's a much longer set of problems to fix. I mean, the people right in this is on the ball in Fairfield. We had replaced the cable and replaced the cable again when it's been cut from other contractors when they're working. You can't see it, fix it. So once you got to go through all the troubleshooting steps and processes for our safety measures, it, kind of commitments greatly as far as fixing the word. You go out there and you have a span of wire down from the tree. If it doesn't break the poles, we can get trucks to it easily accessible. We get the wire put up relatively quick. And once here, if it's underground, we got to call and get locates, just like everybody else. We got to have all the government stuff. We got to get around cell phone, gas. It's a much more complex than overhead, just to be honest with you. That's where we got to fix it.
And also with equipment for underground, say you got trees falling on the equipment. We don't have that type of equipment sitting around. You got three-phase sweeping cabinets that we would have to order.
We have to deliver from our Wimwoods and our Rivers. It's a major equipment like that. Because, you know, it doesn't go bad. So if a tree falls or something like that, we have to have one shipped in.
And late bloomer, I mean, basically, you're sitting on a mountain of grand complex. And as another big tree falls, you know, very shallow. You couldn't clear, if you clear 300 foot up the side of the mountain, there was only a tree that there's somewhere going to fall, tumble down to the edge of the line. So you got a huge challenge there. But even if you could put all the, blast through all this granite, and you could put a duct system in, I mean, and you really kind of hit on your environmental concerns. I mean, you're talking about, you're about to go through tons of root systems of trees. You're talking about having a tremendous impact on the environment.
Definitely. I'm just curious about if there have been those comparisons at all.
So, next week is going to be all around, but that's what it's going to look like. So the surfing on the Merrifield was last trimmed in 2009 and then again in 2019. So we're coming up in a couple of years to be ready to trim that. Now, mention trees out. Yes, ma'am.
First of all, thank you for being here and taking your time to present the information. I was here 5 years ago when you presented. And I realized that there is terrain in our area that prohibits underground piping. Mm-hmm. I realized that. There are places, such as around our beach, where that would be doable. And also, in the last 5 years, has there been technology that has been able to promote this technology and make the vista more appealing? And
so you mentioned the beach. Underground is a lot different down in that terrain. I mean, you heard the discussion about the granite. I mean, it's cost prohibitive. It's very high in the environment. I mean, it's really not feasible to do. And especially,
I realize Buffalo Shoals Road is completely different than 64.
Right.
Granted.
Yes. And 64 in itself is a challenge. So let me move on and talk about hazard trees. I mentioned so many of our customer minutes out are due to trees outside the right of way. So how do we address them? Well, our vets guys are doing patrols, and they're looking for hazard trees. And by that, I mean a tree that's outside the right-of-way, but you can look at it and tell it's in imminent danger of falling. So we'll go and contact the property owner and say, hey, there's this tree here. When it falls, it's going to fall on our line. It's going to call the alleys. We would like to take this tree down. And so we'll figure that. And that takes a lot of patrolling and a lot of conversation and a lot of inaccessible things, but already in 2023, we removed 59 hazard trees that we used just a matter of time. Now, other times you can't, sometimes you can't take it. There's a lot around the ring, going inside. Did you guys want to add anything to our hazard tree discussion?
Yeah, we circuit on our trend plan for the year. That circuit is reviewed as they go through conducting circuit maintenance from start to finish of any tree that's outside the right of way that's dead, dying, diseased, or maybe just significantly into the right of way. Those are targeted for removal. So that covers the hazard tree assessments on those circuits. Every year, any circuit that's not on the trend plan gets an assessment that's done at a level one, which means basically it's an observational review of the circuit to look, and we do it during the season when leaf is on, so you can see dead, dying disease. Where areas are not accessible, they will get out and walk those areas looking for trees that meet that criteria. And then those trees are then targeted for removal over the remaining months of the year. And that's kind of like an ongoing, continuous cycle. And then when we do target, let's say, grid improvement type work, we do a level two assessment on those trees, which is more of a 100% just kind of walking the circuit and looking for dead, dying, and diseased trees. Now, what we can't do is identify, you know, you're not digging up and exposing root systems. And I will tell you, out of the percentage of trees that was mentioned as far as like that are outside or right away that fall, a large percentage of those trees don't even meet the hazard tree criteria. They're live trees, they're healthy. You would not think about taking them down. Tree canopy size made like a live oak, that's just a great example of one. It's real top heavy. The windstorms come blasting through the mountains there, and it will take those large trees and all those leaves just sort of act like a wind sail. And all that force is all placed upon that tree, and it's gone. You know, it's just because maybe it's here, it might be leaving on the line. That tree may fall that way if you communicate it that way, then, you know, it can do that power. So those are some of the challenges we're looking at. Hazard tree program is ongoing, consistent, and really just trying to do our very best to identify every proactive tree we can.
And so thank you for that. And here's a photo I want to share, and I'll request it in a second. So I'm impacted by three little both sides of a road. So you can see just by this photo, there's dozens of trees really on either side of the road that if they fail, they would impact our line. So the trees are just an ongoing challenge for us. So you got a quick question.
Yeah, so as part of the housing tree management program, I'm wondering if there's any policies to lead. If you talk about tree removal, we would love trees to actually be fully removed instead of just left lying dead and sort of the fire hazard for our community. It's also kind of possible to be all trees. So I'm wondering if that's due to policies and compensation to cut down trees and then we're going to try to keep fire hazards.
All policy associated with having trees, we proactively take them down because they do present some risk to our line. We do permission it with the property owners, or we will take the tree down, we'll cut it up in manageable lengths, we'll leave that wood there, and we'll save you that expense of having to pay a contractor to come in there and take a dead tree down on the property. So that is a pretty large benefit if you've ever priced out to take a tree down on the property. However, We will chip up what we can, everything that can be sent to the chipper, but the rest of it is as policy left there for the property.
And point of clarification, please.
In maintained areas, in outside maintained areas, we do not always have to chip everything. You can take the brush and you can regrow it, hash it down. So, yeah.
And in your inside of your right of way, though, I've noticed, you know, it varies based on transmission from each other. Those are fully removed that fall within the right of way of what your, you know, your opportunities are. So I try to always be proactive because we don't want to pay for it. But there's, you know, that's it falls into them, and probably at the end of the day, they save $1,000.
Yeah.
Not having to take it out.
So yeah, really, the key is maintaining there. It's a maintaining there, you know, working through. If it's in the woods and limbs are falling out of trees everywhere, then we leave it. Just as
a reiterate what you said about the live tree. I didn't quite catch what you said.
Well, live trees are a large percentage of the trees from outside of the right of way that fall. And, you know, in a lot of these storms, through the summer seasons, that really like them coming, those afternoon thunderstorms bring a lot of high winds with them. The trees in full canopy, leaves are out. Those leaves basically act like windstorms. grabs the wind, and it puts all, a lot of additional force on the tree. And it's, you know, and then you combine that with the grant that this place, you know, consists of. And then you got a pretty shallow root system there. I will tell you, even in other places, in the flatlands, we, you know, live trees in those scenarios, like the Stephen Shaw, wind is channeled through on storms, like in those urban out here.
Mm-hmm.
And those trees are subject to failure during those type of events, just due to the size, the location of them, and just depends on the intensity of the storm. But they can fall.
Now, are you, you're not restricted from coming and cutting the tree down if the property owner is in grievance? I mean, you will do that if you prevent the step or by.
If it's a live tree, it's and/or it doesn't present a hazard to the facility, mm-hmm. do not typically remove it. Now, every property owner has the option, you can call and request, like if you have a tree that's a concern on your property, you can't call and make a request. It generates an order for our team, they'll come out and send, they will look at the tree with you, they can determine whether or not you can take that tree down for you. And that's all year round thing, you know, anytime. You can evaluate your property. You're not walking our line nearby, you know, then you got a tree you want to look at. We can't help you with that. But I'm not telling you we take every tree down in that situation down, but we will work with you if it.
So, what office do you call, or how do you get in touch with someone to come do an evaluation?
You have a call center. You can call the 800-777-9998. And make a request. Anything vegetation related for distribution is not to happen to us.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate the information.
Yeah,
one really mind boggling, if you think about it, is how late that we had the storm, the wind storm that y'all have had that we haven't had in the flat. The trees will survive on that, on a calm, one of these big platforms will fall for no explanation other than the good Lord just says it's time for you to go.
Yeah.
We don't have any control of that, unfortunately. What you were talking about the debris being left. I'm gonna have to get this from the Dan Anderson, the guy, he was all over me. The exact same scenario I just talked about. Calm, still day, tree fell in the back line situation in his backyard. Tore a pole down for a transformer, the whole works. Same, the whole back line scenario. And finally, I just listened, and I said, can I say something? And he said, you. I said, what would you have done about cleaning this tree up if our power line hadn't been back there? And he looked at me like me looking at me again, like, you ain't supposed to think about it. But that's the way we have to look at it. You know, trees are going to fall in the woods. Regardless if we got our power lines there or not, that doesn't mean that we're going to come clean them up every time they fall. And we might minimize the part of it laying around in a neat pile. And we use little propel boat, but as far as total cleanup, we don't.
Trees falling in the woods, that's a good thing. Actually, for good habitat. But I mean with trees that are cut by Duke and then left.
But it's that kind of debris you were talking about the fire hazard. Whether we cut it or it's all that. We do put a lot more of it on the ground, I agree.
Yeah, but it's stacked up against living trees. Trees don't do that now. Exactly.
All right, so Les, I got a couple more slides and we'll wrap this up and we'll take more questions. So back in 2019, some of you were here and we talked about things we were doing then to work to increase reliability. We talked about increasing capacity of the substation and a second set of conductors going up the Fairfield, replacing failing underground cables in a rumbling bald area. Installing electronic reclosers, and I've talked about that. installing additional opening points to better isolate damaged facilities and minimize customer impacts. Those are those reclosers that I talked about. And the bottom one is really some good news for today is we said we want to long-term explore backfeed capabilities. And I've got some good news on that. Since 2019, we have increased capacity in the substation. Again, we did that in 2023. The reclosers I talked about, opening points, we have implemented new backfeed capabilities on the town hall circuit. So up Highway 9 from Turner and Shoals, we've rebuilt those distribution feeders and now have capacity that we can serve some load in the Lake Lure area. I'll show you a map of that. We built a new $25 million substation in Henderson County near Edneyfield. And that Laycock substation, we call it, we rebuilt a feeder there that comes into Batcave and can tie with the feeder up there to allow us to feed down in this area. Now, that capacity is currently limited during high-load conditions like hot summertime, cold wintertime. And so there's a new project being considered that would upgrade that wire size from Batcave down to Boys Camp Road, and also a project that would upgrade the feeder along Boys Camp Road. So what that looks like is coming from Laycock, from Eddyville area on 64 up to Batcave, we have a normally open switch there. So if Sandy has a problem somewhere, let's say in this area, then he could open a switch on this side, open a switch on this side, and then close that one and pick up all this load from Henderson County. So 5 years ago, we couldn't do that. We're limited right now. We can go to about Boys Camp Road just about all the time. And in low load conditions, we can go further than that. In fact, when we had the substation outage in 2023, we were able to pick up this entire feeder from this source and this other source down. We really built this feeder that goes down the Lake Avenue, and this gives us an opportunity. So if we lose the substation, sits right here. If we lose something here, we can isolate that and then feed this area up from Oak County, which sure. Yeah, 5 years ago, we couldn't do that. So these back feed capabilities are really paying off, really starting in 2023 by the time we got everything operational. Again, we're hopeful that we'll get this this project moved through to do this reconductor work from Batcave down to Boys Camp Road. Guys, was that pretty good?
Yeah, good.
Fairly accurate. So that's the backfeed capability, and we'll move into questions, and then I'll make sure that I address what's on the list. So,
thank you for being here. We're saying that we said we have to stop at $15 million to upgrade theaters and stations. Would you consider sending some money to very someone who very spent of the checks towards them, which is what the community lives on, around the lake, for example?
So the stop station does not need millions. In Henderson County was happening to build a whole new substation for load growth in that area. So that was a huge investment and, you know, to serve load in that area. But it gave us a chance to go that 7.5 miles and build a feeder with large capacity to come down and provide a backfeed. You know, looking at targeted underground areas, we've done a little bit of that, but that's really limited. That's something we have to get permission from the utilities commission to do. And it's you see us build that on feeder backbone just because the ductway just makes it cost prohibitive.
Would you consider partnering with the town, or are we still going to take that out?
I mean, we talked about, we talked about areas over there, the restaurant across the way.
We've looked at that. We've looked at the area around the marina that comes around from like the beach area here. And we've had those conversations with the town over the years, and it's just called
it. Okay, Greg, with the Utilities Commission, too, like your line is one, maybe two of those, but you've got a transmission line for following
the utilities. That's
all these other things, but like your one piece of the puzzle for underground aerial. Providers that also are going to have to go down underneath in the same vein if you want to create a travel room.
That's a great point. So,
yeah. But like there are, you know, a couple spots where you just have to kind of take that, you know, could be good for your line, but then your internet is going to go down. Like in 18, we all lost internet, telephone, power to the Island Creek and the down here, Island Creek and 9. 64. Everything went down for 3 days. Yeah.
So it
becomes a little more complex situation outside of just the nuclear team.
You're exactly right. That certainly adds to the problem.
For me, so, that's a bigger point of concern is the other utility commissions too that are part of this puzzle that you know have to do the same thing if with that right over to reach.
So the way, you know, we're addressing those reliability concerns, but again, we're trying to keep up our abilities to bring in alternate feeds, to isolate problems, to minimize the number of customers that are out, and keep everybody energized. Yes.
A while back, there were attacks on substations throughout the country. Are there, what are you doing? You know what I mean? If there's anything that can be done to protect those substations from just some dumbass shooting at it.
You kind of nailed it there. Yes, there's someone vandalized a couple substations down in Moore County in late 2022, and we spent 3 or 4 days repairing transformers. It's a huge deal, and it's something we're taking very seriously. We're working with the federal government, the FBI, the whole utility across the country looking at it. But just Duke Energy has thousands of substations. And, you know, in Craig's simple mind, you think about, well, let's build a big barricade around it, and then, you know, you think about the technology that's out there with drones and everything else. So we're deploying technology, cameras, a lot of different, taking a multifaceted approach to it. But
I also understand that some of these equipments that are inside the substation take a long time to get used.
Absolutely.
You know, they're not made in America.
So yeah, I mean, Sammy mentioned bringing his equipment from the Charlotte, Greensboro, and Raleigh. So you know, we got spared, but you're right. You have to order any one of those. They're long lead times for sure. So
I want to circle back to the underground utilities a couple of years back when the Karen called it exactly.
Sorry for the delay. I was dealing with my elderly dog, but so that's part two and a half, and there's one last part here in a second. This is the last section of the meeting. So part of the summary, some of the most important takeaways from the meeting happened in this section, including the various ways and chemicals that are used near waterways. So that, take a listen to that. What's the process regarding a pole and other utilities equipment? How does that work? And what are the switches? What are the strategies, you know, to minimize customer outage times? And after this section, I'll go into a little bit of detail about what happened the week of this event, just 2 days later. Take a listen.
They wanted me to need additional access to my property and community, the neighborhoods where I live. And they wanted to go ahead and start the process of putting underground utilities in my neighborhood. The main concern was it didn't include cable, it didn't include internet, it didn't include like the telephone company. So there was still going to be above ground line. It would have eliminated the telephone pole per se, but I didn't understand why there's already a deep access into my property and to others, why they needed an additional 10 to 15 feet in order to accomplish that. I didn't find the deep, but I did not understand that, and I could not get the telephone pole to come from anybody.
So that sounds like our targeted underground program, where folks like Danny will look at reliability over time and say, Sandy, what's going on? So Sandy looks at it and goes, well, it's inaccessible, and we have vegetation all the time, and it looks like this terrain is reasonable that we could do some berries. We wouldn't have to do duck planes. We could just we can put it in conduit. And so, that's the program the Utilities Commission said, look, over time, you're going to save money. So we do that in targeted areas. That's the name of the program, targeted underground. Why? Usually we do that within that 30-foot right-of-way. I don't know why. There must have been something unique. Maybe we need to shift the overhead lines here. And to do the underground, we need to shift the corner a little bit. But that's speculation. Matt, would you add anything to targeted underground?
It all depends on what's in the ground. There's so much stuff in the ground. We may have to move over here just to achieve what we need to achieve for that targeted underground. That would be what I would think.
Can I clarify that? Because I had called my office representative when they came to my residence. And the way it explained to me was we just have to have it for the buffer zone, blah, 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 blah. And I said, well, you already have a deep right of way access through my property. I'm not going to give up additional
feedback. But I think the key is, all these different utilities. So, we can say, well, we want the power there, okay? Well, all we'll do is take our stuff off the pole.
Right.
The pole ain't going over. It's not. Because you got, it's like the gentleman said, 5 or 6 utilities that, whether they agree, whether they go to their commission to try to reach it. I mean, there's just so many pieces of the puzzle to get something done. And it's reality.
And there's no ability to cost share with the various utility companies, like the cable, telephone, and all of those.
Regulated by different pieces of the puzzle, and it's interesting.
So Pat asked about trees, and we talked about trees. You also asked about building, and we'll save all this. I'll address the building in one. I think it was Aaron asked about rodeo.
This is when technology fails us. It says building, but he said billing. I find Otter AI doesn't like North Carolina accents sometimes. So now he's going to finally discuss billing.
I don't think we talked about that. You guys want to talk about, we do use herbicides on our transmission right-of-ways and sometimes on the distribution right-of-ways. it's an excellent program. And guys, talk about perfect balance, right?
My apologies. He's going to discuss billing in a bit. This is about herbicides and those important, potentially dangerous chemicals that need to be carefully examined, and their policies are, I'll say, a little wonky on the subject.
Our program is an integrated-based planting program. We talk about the trend cycle, where we begin here doing maintenance every 7 years. Generally, we'll start with all kinds of tree programs. Herbicide program is another part of it. We don't, all products that we use are certainly approved by EPA. The herbicide program is conducted on foot. They use local pressure, backpack sprayers. It's very targeted. It's a non-compatible species that are growing in the right of way. The mixture for mountains areas does not contain glyphosate. It's a mixture of different products, but it does not contain glyphosate. And so anywhere there's near water sources, I'm sorry, I said that wrong. The mountain products do contain glyphosate. My bad. Because of the water source, it is the only product approved to use around part of the past that it does around water sources. So in the product that we do use in this area does contain some glyphosate. But like I said, it is targeted, low pressure backpack sprayer. Incompatible species, like there's a pine tree popping up there, they target that. It's very important piece of keeping our floor clear. It is a very cost-effective way of keeping the floor clear. It also, keeping the floor clear, also allows desirable species to flourish. And organizations like Tree Line, we've been recognized by those organizations, we've been recognized by environmental groups as far as having these flowers that are beneficial for everything from monarch butterflies and things of that nature for their path, along their journey. All of those open right of ways provide ways for them to navigate, their journey each year. So there's a lot of benefits outside of just helping maintain the flow and keep the flow of food. But it is a method that we use to help maintain that overall easement.
Another important part of it is the product that we use up here. If you know anything at all about herbicides, pesticides, any of the ides, they're legal. The product that we use up here in the mountains is all aquatic, which means we don't normally spray in the water, but if it happens to get in the water, it's not going to hurt. If you can imagine, I think we'll all agree, if we spray around a creek or a stream or even in your wet, we get called all the time about, they spray right on top of my lake. The way the products work, they go down into the soil, depending on the soil content. It actually, when the product goes through the plant, out the roots into the soil, the soil actually starts breaking down that product as soon as it hits the soil. Depending on the soil makeup, it may take a month or so for it to completely go away, but it will eventually go away and not, it won't go over, depending on the roots, deep in the area. It's not going. It's not going to get down deep enough to upset, get water in the whales. Even if it were toxic stuff, if I can use that term, it's not going to bother you drinking water. If the DNR got a call and where we had sprayed, and they had a match to frog kill, fish kill, bird kill. It's, we don't have that. The reason being, it's not going to affect anyone. I thought that's pretty much a common sense thing. I thought we could all agree on that.
No.
All right.
We don't make everybody happy. We know that.
All right, so you guys hang around and talk with the subject matter experts after the meeting, and we'll talk through that. Mark up in Rumbling Ball asked about dirty power, momentary interruption, folded sack, all that thing. I hope that kind of makes sense now. See how, we're going to have faults in our system. We're looking to clear those faults, get the system back to normal. So we're going to have momentaries, we're going to have things like that, we're going to have outages, and, for companies who have delicate equipment, there's technology, there's uninterrupted power sources. I mean, there's things you can deploy, but that's kind of what's causing that. Cost of generators. So every customer, I've been a large company for a lot of years from Mission Hospital to the paper mill in Canton and a lot of other industrials. A 10-minute outage means a lot of different things to different customers. A 10-hour outage means a lot of different things. The only money we have comes out of your pocket, okay? That's how we operate utilities. So utilities commission is taking the approach of, hey, whatever your impact, whatever a customer's impact is from an outage, they need to take care of it because it's different for everyone. So we don't have a pot of money to help customers buy backup generation. So that's, if you're in a situation where you have a critical need for power, then unfortunately the customer is going to be responsible for that cost. Hillary asked about rate increases, weatherization, that kind of thing. I'll catch that all together at the very end if we can. Liz from Roman Ball asked about low heating cables. And Roman Ball, that's the first I've heard of that. Sammy, are you familiar with that?
She said up Young's Mountain, is what she said. So going up Young's Mountain, there is some older poles up there that are 20-foot poles. Our wire is already at the standard it's supposed to be at, the height it's supposed to be at. The other companies that have attached our cable, theirs might not be. You know, when it gets tore down and they put it back up, I don't know who's out there to see them put it back up, but ours is an industry standard of whether it's 16-foot for secondary or whatever over a road. So, we're down with the property on 40-foot poles. There is some old 35-foot poles in the area that are old and accessible, but that we're getting to a change that is a little lower than that.
But the communication companies say that they will not do any repairs on their lines until poles are repaired.
So there is an encroachment level between us and them, and we have to maintain that. They maintain that for their safety when they're installing it. So, depending on what it is, we'd have to go out and measure that. We run into this. We have, in my area, I have all of them, all the folks, some of the interesting people. I run into this all the time. If we have people pulling in fiber now or something like that, some of these other companies, they'll be pulling it across the road. It'll be 18-wheeler. When they've installed it incorrectly, they don't put their guys down. Where they get their people to put their stuff in them, they'll be running into problems. They'll start pulling against our poles without guys, which pulls our poles over, which slacks things off. And then they'll go back and try to pull guys and the poles like a broke arm. And we run into trouble like that all the time. It's just dangerous.
Can I speak to what you just said?
Yes.
It's ironic that you brought that up and what you just said. Coming down Kimmel Rock Road, down by the river, there's obviously been some storm damage of some kind. There's a telephone cable. I'm not talking about a little bit. I'm talking about a huge telephone cable, communication line, that is actually tied off to the post holding the guardrail.
Yeah.
Wow. So that's a good example of what Sammy's talking about.
And on the same thing, they have roots tying their lines.
Like if you call us, we immediately, and it's good to see the fire chiefs in here. I saw Chris and Dustin's here. We have a great relationship with them. They call me all the time. They call a lineman.
So, you know, if somebody don't know, so the customer called in, something went on, the fire department's on the scene and already rolled up on, they know what the problem is. They'll call me directly, they'll call a lineman, they'll call one of my crews. So we bypassed a lot of time. I'm already implementing getting trucks going this way. We have trees down across 64. We can't access, you know, get near. I'll roll the trucks right on up. Intersville, jump back in the back way because our back feeds coming from the Intersville side, they're still things, even though it's automated. We know how the internet is up here. It's not always reliable. So we still run some issues. It is automated at Lake Pop right there at 64, 74 at the bridge, but we'll run into some internet issues right there sometimes. So that is always one of the first plays is somebody up and around. We get somebody on this side, we have somebody on both sides. I know everyone is affected when the tree goes across the road. We try to take that into effect and hire them to fix the thing. I'll call Fred immediately to let him know, hey, let them know the guys have going to have to block the whole road. Or we're going to just depending on which curve it's in, or the problem is trouble, how the tree lands, you know, what's wrong with that thing. But there is just so many things that I've been and the Duke is doing really well in this area. Some people may not agree, but the backfeed options now will ride and we'll look at places where, hey, we get these customers on the new rest of the parking lot administrator. We pick all those people up. We have went out and proactively home switches places where we don't have electronics, though, where, hey, this is minimizing the customer. We'll hang it right on the other side right here at the dam. Not the dam, keep them right here in front of the beach. So we'll get La Strada home. There's a set of switches there. You can rock the road up here. If we pass the old store on the left, one back out, there's on switches right there. So we need to back feed from the side. We proactively pick up all the businesses. We try to keep all of them on. It's come from the other side. We have switches everywhere. We implemented them and come out strategically, especially when things fall, we'll ride through and look again. Like, let's go here and let's add this. And we'll call our, I'll call my manager, Mr. Green here, and we'll go in and we'll be like, yep, let's go ahead and take these switches. So it proactively makes us better for the next time. So we've got switches and all kinds of capabilities. We try to do that in all these areas. Is it perfect? No, but we're trying. The back people in Columbus and Lake Office offered us many, many areas of opportunity to keep people on. We had the outage at the substation back in 2023. I think it was August or something. We were able to pick up all the customers. And didn't have anybody off. It could have been to happen during the middle of the night. We're proactively trying to make it as good as it possibly be, keeping Lake Norman beautiful. The trees, the area here, like I said, I'm from here. I love the mountains. I love seeing all this, but it's a bare corner to block this terrain with our vehicles. We got track equipment. You know, they have to go the old fashioned way. The guys are stumping in the middle of the night. And we have all kinds of animals up here, too. All the snakes and the critters, you know, they're fighting all that, crawling up under whatever is going in these areas. And they're doing the best they can to get to those spots.
If I may just real quick, if I could send you the phone numbers that are an issue up there, the posts are literally pieces of a post being held together with wood. And I know as soon as I say communications company, it's fault, it's not our own. I get that, but they won't do anything until the posts are here. So I'll send you those phone numbers. I have them all over for
you. And I got off a little bit of this. What I meant to say was, is when you call Luke Energy, we come immediately. We don't do anything on the ground. We can't. And it's a safety hazard for you. If somebody has a generator and you have to blow put it in and it's not live correctly, it could kill anybody. You know, we work with our fire department, make sure they stay off of keep people away from it until we get there because it is not protected, you know. That second right there, take your life, change your life. So we, as fast as we can, and get to those points, and we don't leave stuff on the ground. Our cable companies and our phone companies, like you said, Mr. Proctor said, you know, they're tied up on guardrails, tied to trees, tied everywhere, and then lay there till they're replaced. They'll fix it. We fix everything we can to try to fix it right.
So I have a question. I live out on Ohio, and we're with the end of everything. Whether it's a cable or a tow, everybody, we got an end spot there. Okay. Yeah, you guys put up great poles, you put up new poles.
The other utilities are still attached to the old poles.
Right.
I was told that it's their responsibility to transfer their service to the new pole.
So we move only our stuff. We're not certified to move anybody with their father, because we don't work on their stuff. We don't maintain.
Okay, I get that. So they tell me that they rent space on that pole from Duke. Okay. Yeah, I got you. And so is there any way that you guys, as the parents of that pole, can say, you've got 90 days to move your stuff?
I wish we could, but we can't. So what, how that all works, when we change the pole though, the guys come back into the office and we put your paperwork on the computer. It goes into a process called engines, and it's actually NJUNS. And that notifies the other utilities that are on that pole that there's a new pole installed, and they should be able to come and transfer their stuff. We have solved the top of it off down to where they are, and they need to come transfer their conductors. Does it get done? No.
No.
But we can't move their stuff.
Okay.
So, you know, sometimes we'll...
So we have to talk to every utility company.
Yeah, and sometimes, you know, I've known municipalities that maybe a county commissioner calls or the mayor calls, or, you know, and there are places where if it's an intersection, it creates a safety hazard because there's big holes there. So, you know, if there's a way to lean on those companies.
Okay.
Sweden will disagree. Okay. So we have some questions about billing and all that. Before I get into that, are there any other questions about liability, holding wires?
Yeah. Can you clarify how it stands now? How I saw your maps about how the electric runs from Polk County. So I cover, as a journalist, I cover Western North Carolina, but primarily the Lake Lure area. So I'm curious about the inter-county communications, if you can speak to any of that, and how does it stand now? Like, how does Rumbling Bald get their power? Are they getting it from the Lake Adger Dam, or where is that power coming from?
So county lines generally don't matter enough. We kind of run things by the grid. So there are certain substations that are assigned to certain op centers. And so the county doesn't really matter. On the transmission grid, the whole country's interconnected, except for Texas, that's a different story. So you got a Eastern interconnect, a Western interconnect. And so electricity takes the path least resistance. So, you know, is the electricity coming from Turner Shoals? Does it come from the generator at the dam? Well, maybe sort of. It depends on the ohms law. Okay, it takes a path of least resistance that it moves at the speed of light. And so, your light's still on when Lake Adger's not running? Yes, they are. So it depends. It's hard to say. Duke Energy has a balancing area in the Carolinas, and it's our responsibility to provide resources to cover that load in that area. But where it goes depends on the law of business.
My last question is about Rutherford Electric Membership Corporation. I myself live in Green Hill and have REMC. So how does Duke and REMC's relationship really work for the layperson to understand?
They're connected to our transmission group. So we'll have a substation just like our substations that are scattered around. We'll have a Rutherford Electric one in the lease. So like I showed in that first diagram, the transmission line will be ours. They'll own the substation. They'll set it down from 44,000 volts down to 12,000 volts. And then they distribute it pretty much like we do. And they purchase wholesale power from the
host
utility. Any other questions about electric
reliability? Yeah, this is just rather specific of where I am. I know the folks in that cave along 2474 have really benefited from the fact that you come down from Hendersonville. Any chance you got to run it up 9? Because I've been told we were having a lot of trouble with power.
So
that was with 5 was.
So your power, you're up for barrel.
No, I'm not getting off our orders.
Still that's a benefit. So, you know, 5 years ago, if we had a problem anywhere, between there and the dam, you're out. But now, you know, if there's a problem here, we open this recloser here, we close that one, and all of this comes back on. So that helps you.
Well, I've noticed the difference. I noticed when I first moved up here, that they pulled all power 14 miles and 12 miles for a significant period of time. And they, at the time when I saw them, probably one gentleman, regularly they said that the infrastructure was in the area that nine in that area. And
yeah.
You got to have those some good work and things and that. But I didn't know that they had run that.
Yeah, so that feed taps on, and it, you know, it can feed all of that. Any other reliability, like a pole and water?
I have a follow-up question, right quick.
Okay.
Regarding the, what was the name of the non-rodeo product that you said was used on, like, near water? Did you
know? We don't mind if I can get with you after this. We can,
oh, I'm
right. Get your email, and we can give you the formula that we use.
Oh, I don't think is there other community members considering the health risks involved with some of these materials? And I know that there are backpack sprayers, but the fact that they're being sprayed near waterways, it is a huge health concern. So if you do have some product needs, like I'm sure.
Well, okay. We can give you that. These are, I mean, the EPA water approved products. I mean, you know, it's
yeah. I still love their names. So that's okay.
So you guys get with them after this. We've been here 90 minutes, so we're gonna wrap it up later. But I will speak to the billing issue right quick. Couple things going on. Utilities and the Carolinas have what we call fuel meters. So the price we pay for coal, the price we pay for natural gas is fluctuating. So every year we estimate what we're going to spend on fuel, and if fuel costs are higher than anticipated, then we under collect. So every year we have a fuel case, and it's a pass through for a utility. So last fall, we did have an increase due to fuel. So the price of natural gas was really high, 21, 22 time frame. So I don't remember the exact percentage. I should have looked for the meeting. I want to say it's like maybe in the 10%, 10, 12 maybe. But that's something that changes every year. So that fuel cost goes up. The next fuel case, it may go down. So it kind of fluctuates depending on natural gas and coal prices are really what drive that. The second thing that went on is we did have a general rate case, and those new rates went into effect January 15th. There was about an 8.3% increase for customers of Duke Energy Carolinas. And so we're doing a lot of infrastructure upgrades, a lot of investments in infrastructure, and you've seen some of that. We talked about some of that today. Not only these improving reliability, but also getting our grid to ready to accept two-way flows that we get from renewables. So the gentleman asked a question about solar. So we're seeing electricity flowing two ways on our system. It hadn't been that way for 100 years, but now we're seeing it. Then the other thing that's really got a lot of people talking is the cold weather that we had. We had one week of really cold weather, so that's driving the energy consumption. We also broke out some rider charges, like that fuel increase and decrease. This year was an increase. All these charges were lumped into what we call a rider, and there's storm recovery costs. There's a whole list of about a dozen of them. It's on our website. Some of them add to the kilowatt hour cost. Some of them take away from the kilowatt hour cost. It's all kind of adjustments. That's always been built into the kilowatt hour cost. It wasn't a line item on your bill. Well, we decided in January, February to make it a line item right on the heels of all this cold weather. I'm not sure why we did that, but it created a lot of confusion for customers. And so, you know, it depends on the number of kilowatt hours you use. If you use 1,000, and I'm quoting, I'm making up numbers, maybe it's $18. If you use 2,000, you know, it's $39. And, you know, neighbors talk across the fence line, this new charge, mine was 18, and the neighbor says, well, crap, mine was 36. This don't make any sense. So that's created a lot of confusion. Those are not new costs. They've always been there. They were just built into the total before. So there's a combination of about four things that are really, really creating confusion for customers. But high bills are generally being driven by higher usage. Costs have gone up a little bit, but you know, not double what you're kind of hearing on the media. So with that, it's been an hour and a half. We're going to hang around. We'll talk about the solar question. I'll be glad to talk about weather stripping and those kind of things. Any other thing from my colleagues? If not, I'll turn it back over to the mayor. Thank you for being here.
There you have it. That was word for word from the Duke Energy officials at the Lake Lore Town Meeting in late February. Here is the presentation. I'll include a link to this in my story, but wanted to run through it briefly with you, entitled Electric Reliability in the Hickory Knot Gorge. So some of what, of course, he went through this as he was speaking, but these are the team members. And there's various graphs throughout. What was very interesting to me and somewhat surprising was the fact that he said their main feeder line is from Lake Adger in Polk County to Lake Lore. So keep that in mind. What happens in Polk County matters to the electric reliability in Lake Lore. They discussed the restoration after 2020 hurricane and that situation and various trees. Here's another photo. And some of these maps, you really have to zoom in to really understand the intricate details of it all. He described how he selected a particular address, Lake Lore Town Hall, and saw the customer minutes out at that particular address. The average was 1,660 minutes, according to this graph. So that means during the past five years, 71% of minutes out are due to trees outside the right of way, according to this other graph. So we discussed trees. Here's the helicopter trimming trees. They did do some tree trimming, is my understanding, and how lines are impacted by trees on both sides of the road. I mean, there's definitely some significant geographic challenges to having electric infrastructure that really is modernized. So they discuss all of that and also looking at neighboring substations like in Hendersonville and Eddyville. So here's are all of those maps. Thanking you for sticking through this and watching that entire meeting with me. It was very enlightening and I hope it helps you make an informed decision and gives you some more knowledge about the critical infrastructure and electric needs in Lake Lore and the greater area. Finally, over 3,000 Duke Energy customers were without power on February 23rd. No specific cause had been determined. I still don't know if they ever determined a cause just 2 weeks later now. And of course, this came on the heels of that meeting. So it's a very fragile ecosystem, and one tree down could essentially wipe out power for a prolonged period of time. So keep that in mind, be extra vigilant, and I appreciate your support. Feel free to follow me on social media, Facebook, Annie M. Dance, or if you search anniedance.substack.com, you should find my page. I'm also on Twitter at Annie M. Dance. And of course, feel free, please subscribe to anniedance.substack.com. Again, I'm working to shine a light on these important issues in the Lake Lore area. I'm an independent journalist. Please subscribe. I am not owned or governed by anyone but myself and public records. Thank you for your support.